Welcome everybody. It's time for the week 12 garden tour here at Reach and Reverie. And y'all are in for a treat because it's a great day to harvest. Got my little makeshift trug with my pruners. So let's get started. Let's go take a look. So into the garden we go. Before we start, let's just take a moment to look around and see what has changed this week. I don't know if I've shown you guys before, but we have a little cactus friend living in the top of this stump. This little Pokemon mascot that the kids brought. It's pretty cute. The morning glory is looking good up here. The leaves are really starting to show the nice green color that I've been looking for. And the leaves on the bottom are still a little spotty with some like early blight kind of look to them. But look at that new growth. That's pretty nice. My parsley plant is pretty much gone. Remember last week during the week 11 garden tour, this thing was covered with this mysterious unidentified caterpillar. Well, I actually found out that they were black swallowtail caterpillars. There might be a couple left on here, but really they've eaten pretty much all of the growth on this parsley plant and have since turned into beautiful butterflies and flown away. I also have an okra plant that I think the wild birds started getting to. I mean, it could have been a caterpillar, but I don't know. I'm kind of keeping an eye on it. It does look pretty healthy still. I don't know what's eating on it. So I'm going to come out here and look and try to find some caterpillars. But I do know that when I come out here, I usually see about 20 sparrows and some doves flying out of this garden. So I know they're in here for a reason. They're going after something. I'm not sure if they are doing this or if that's caterpillar damage. Now let's talk about this corn here. I actually think that I am going to pull this corn out. It looks pretty good. I mean, it's healthy, but the thing is, I grew corn this year so that I could learn how to grow corn. And I am fairly certain that any of the corn that I have here is going to be really poorly pollinated because I just didn't grow it in a big enough space. So I don't really want to use this amount of space, this amount of real estate in my raised garden beds for something that I already feel like I've learned a lot from, but I am not going to reap very many more benefits from this. But I think I'm just going to go ahead and pull this out, and it's still early enough in the season that I can go ahead and plant something else in its spot and get another harvest out of that plant. I am wearing my aw shucks shirt today, and that's kind of how I feel about this corn. Aw shucks, like I do feel like I learned a lot from growing corn, but I'm a little disappointed that I didn't get a little bit more success on the pollination. And you know, I had it coming because I did grow corn when I already saw it needed a minimum of a 4-foot by 4-foot block to grow it in. And I'm like, 3 by 3, that's not that much smaller. I'm gonna give it a try. And the proof is in the pudding. I mean, look at this. Let me go ahead and it's happening, you guys. Pull off this ear of corn and let's see what is inside of it. All right, you guys, so I'm gonna see how much of this corn is actually developed. And the reason that I know that it's ready to pull off is because the end here has already dried up. So let's go ahead and see what we got. Oh my gosh. Oh my gosh, this is adorable. Look at this. You see that? So here you can see all of these kernels that are nice and developing, those are pollinated. And over here, That right there is a little bit of poor pollination. So I'm actually glad that I went ahead and pulled this off so that I could see that. It looks like it got like maybe, what do you think, 30% germinate or pollinated. So that shows me that I made the right decision. I'm gonna go ahead and pull out the rest of this corn and we'll see what we got. I can also see this variety is called dwarf bronze corn. So whenever it is done maturing, it should be like a really deep orange red color. So that shows me like, yeah, I did pull this off a little early. It would have still developed. These kernels would have been really nice. You can use this corn as a sweet corn. It's not very sweet though. Or you can dry it out and grind it up into a flour. You could do either thing with this variety of corn. But either way, it was a little early. I do want to kind of try it and see what it would have tasted like. It's still young and it should have been a darker red matured. Like it would have been bright orange. Let me try it. The corn flavor's there, but it's really starchy. Wasn't ready yet. So I think I'm gonna give all of these that I pull out today to the chickens. They're gonna enjoy it. So that's neat. It has a nice like kind of planty aftertaste. So that really shows me this wasn't ready. But instead of spending several more weeks letting this little corn ripen up and get ready and waste a lot of space in my garden, I'm gonna use this opportunity to pull it out, say, I learned something. Aw shucks, it wasn't as successful as I wanted it to be. But I'm gonna make the most of this and I'm still gonna use that garden space and plant something else that maybe we'll have a little bit more success with. But either way, this year's a classroom and I'm gonna learn something from it. So, say bye-bye corn. That might be the last we see of it. And let's test this out. I'm gonna give them this one. If they don't like it, then I'm not really sure what I'm gonna do with the rest of the corn, but chickens know what's good for them. And if it's not ready and not good for eating, they won't eat it. Look, girls. Let's see if they like it. It looks like they like it. So that shows me I can. I'm gonna go ahead and harvest the rest of the corn and they're gonna get a little snack today. Look at him fight over it. There'll be more girls, don't worry. Another type of plant that I'm just gonna go ahead and pull out and start over with are my black beauty zucchini and my dark green zucchini. But both of my zucchini plants in this garden bed have failed. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna go ahead and pull these out. The chickens are gonna get another lovely snack today. And then I am going to amend this soil just a little bit. I'm going to add some compost. I'm going to add some minerals and nutrients to make the soil just a little bit more rich. And then I'm going to set the next plant that I plant in this half of the garden bed up for the best success. I mean, look at that. Not a single zucchini is on this plant. And then this plant has grown out and over and is touching the floor. And I don't have a single zucchini on this plant. I might try zucchini again, maybe a different variety, and we'll see, you know, what we can do. But I know that so far this season, we're halfway through the growing season here in Western Texas, and this half of the garden bed is not giving me anything. So I'm learning from it, but I'm also gonna move forward. Just gotta keep moving forward, so. The second half of the garden bed's doing wonderfully. I have my ground cherries and they are struggling quite a bit in the heat. They're not as tall and rigid as they had been earlier in the season. They're also being ravaged by flea beetles, but they're still pretty healthy. I think the biggest thing for these is the heat. So next year if I grow ground cherries, I'm going to provide them with more shade cloth, something like a burlap cover over them so that they can get just a little bit of help getting out of so much sun. The way that you can tell that ground cherries are ready is that their fruit will fall to the ground. Hence the name, ground cherry. So look at that. Just got three of them right there. Let's see what else we can get. Look at that. And I am coming out here every single day and harvesting ground cherries. And this is just two plants. So I actually am really fond of the flavor of a ground cherry. To me, it's not the way that I've heard the flavor described by others. I think that these are the Aunt Molly's ground cherry. They taste to me like a nice tart grape with a hint of a tomato flavor. And it's actually really pleasant and sweet. So you think a nice sweet fruit that has a flavor of a tomato, like that doesn't sound good. Well, they are. They're really, really good. Absolutely love it. Let's see if we can get any more. There's one. And so this one fell off. The husk is soft, so I'm going to set this out on the counter, and these will save and preserve for up to a couple of weeks. I dropped it. And you know that they're ready when the husk is like papery. So that one probably fell just a little early. Now look at this. This one's still a little green, so he could probably, you know, sit out for a couple more days and then he would be really, really ready. I'm actually trying to save up quite a few so that I can make a nice little pie out of these. Look, that one's really pretty and yellow, ready to go. So I'm going to probably set out the soft ones, and then the ones with the paper husks I might try to bake something with. I have a ton of these on my counter already because I've been saving up enough to make a really nice dessert out of. But look at that. We're getting about that many every single day. So pretty good for two plants. I think if I had my ideal scenario, I'd probably be growing 10 of these a year just so that I could really make a lot of food. And, you know, have a nice little snack. Come out in the garden, grab a ground cherry, move on. Very nice. This blue beauty tomato in the corner over here, which is growing in the ground, is growing a lot of really beautiful foliage. This is one of those plants that experimentally I have not pruned very much. I've pruned the leaves on the bottom just to keep it healthy with airflow. But as far as the upper foliage, I just wanted to let it go and see what would happen. So it is growing suckers all over the place, and it's getting nice and bushy. This is one tomato plant, but there's no flowers and no fruit on this thing. So that really shows me that pruning indeterminate tomatoes is the way to go. And there's another example of a sucker. If you really want good production on your indeterminate tomatoes, you just need to pick these things off just like that. And the plant, instead of growing another long branch, this would become a long branch. It's going to put energy into growing flowers and fruit. So I am respecting the wasps' space. There's a couple wasps. There's one right there and a couple in my watermelon. And what they're doing is they are hunting for bugs. I don't really like wasps very much. They freak me out. I don't want to get stung, but I kind of leave them alone up to this point because they're great natural predators. This morning, I was out here watering my garden and there was a wasp on my tomatillo plant, and it was really kind of crazy because it had a beetle in its mouth and it was just kind of dragging it away from the plant. And there was this little trail of beetle juice left over. And I'm thinking, oh, I wish I had my camera on me to show you guys, because it was truly like a wildlife documentary. It was kind of epic. So I'm going to try to get more footage like that. But I do see quite a few. I think I counted 3 wasps in this general area. So I'm kind of letting them do their thing before I head over there. I'm kind of allergic to wasps. Like last time I got stung, it took about 3 months for that bite or that sting to heal. So I try to give them a huge amount of respect in the garden, and I don't do anything to kill the wasps unless, you know, they were to try to to sting me, but generally if you leave them alone, they'll leave you alone. So maybe I will go this way today. Up to this point this year, I haven't actually been stung by anything, and I haven't even been bitten by anything, which really surprises me because I'm always like brushing up against this foliage, especially for my tomatillos, which are growing wildly out of control. And my corn and my squash always have a ton of carpenter ants on them, like the one that's crawling around right there. These ants are huge. I mean, I don't know, they might not be carpenter ants. We got some pretty big ants though. And I haven't been bitten yet, and I'm always like rubbing on them. So I think part of it is just have respect for your garden. Understand that there is an ecosystem going on. And generally, if you're not out to get them, they will avoid you as well. So, and look at this. Last week, week 11, I had told y'all that I had pruned a path. And again, the tomatillos are growing over. So I'm probably going to prune again and keep doing that throughout the season, because my tomatillos, they are just untamable. My squash, it doesn't look really beautiful, but it is working pretty well. My pumpkin is growing all the way up pretty high now. It's probably like, what, 3.5 feet tall now. And I am seeing a couple female flowers, so fingers crossed we're gonna get some pumpkins growing. I also have a really nice butternut squash that's growing here, and it is a pretty good size. I have another one growing over there. My nasturtiums are really green. My basil's looking pretty. I find more areas to pinch off every time I come out here, because I want it to grow bushy. We don't need any of those beautiful flowers. So I'll throw that in there. One of my bell pepper plants has decided just to kind of lean over, and it's using the back trellis for the tomato plants as its own kind of support system. These guys have really beautiful white flowers and really pretty pale fruit. This is the albino bell pepper. Look, that one's kind of long and skinny. How funny looking. I'm not going to pick any bell peppers today. I want these to get a little bigger. I am, however, going to pick some red, juicy tomatoes from my Blue Beauty beefsteak tomatoes. Doesn't fit. Oh, it does. Okay, good. All right. So look there. This is a Blue Beauty beefsteak tomato, and it has anthocyanins, which means that wherever the sun hits it, it gets this bluish skin. And what's really cool about this blue color is it's packed with antioxidants, and it's really healthy for you. Now, this right here is a side effect of getting some nasty heavy rain the other day, and then right afterwards, we get our rain like in the middle of the afternoon, the sun came out again. And when you get heavy rain followed by intense heat and humidity, your tomatoes can crack open. So that's all right. We'll take him. We can cut off this one part. Sometimes when they split, they'll scab over, like you see here. But these look kind of deep, and you might get some rot. So if you're expecting a heavy rain and you see that your tomatoes are really close to being ready to pick, you can actually pick your green tomatoes, set them on the counter for, you know, 3 or 4 days, and they will ripen up on the counter and you won't have that splitting. I didn't get to this one in time, so I'm probably just going to cut off these sections, but overall, that's a really nice tomato. Look at how nice and shady and cool it is right here. It's like a little jungle. I'm like crouched under my jalapenos and my crazy tomatillo branch. So today I'm going to go ahead and harvest some of my black Hungarian jalapenos. And look there, I'm going to show you, because it always takes my breath away. Look at how pretty those flowers are. That's a really beautiful purple flower from our black Hungarian jalapenos. You know, I'm not seeing any fruit development on my brown jalapenos, but they also have really pretty flowers in their own right. They give a white flower. All right. So we got one. It's actually really hard to harvest these while I'm holding the camera on my lap. But there's another really pretty jalapeno. Oh, there's a little beetle on this one. Little plant bug. Now, some of these bugs are beneficial to the garden and others are not. Now, instead of putting a lot of pesticides into my garden, I'm really kind of letting the ecosystem take over now. Now that I'm having a lot of flowering plants that need pollinators to have fruit, I don't want to put anything on my plants that's going to hurt them. So what I'm doing is letting my lacewings that I released do their job. I'm also letting wasps have their area in the garden. I see a ton of praying mantises in the garden as well. If I see one today, I'll go ahead and point them out to you guys. Isn't that kind of funny looking? I don't know if he's good or bad, but if he's bad, he will feed the good predators and that'll bring more things like praying mantises and wasps into my garden. Okay, now that he's away, I'm gonna grab this jalapeno, just like that. I think that's all of my little jalapenos. If I have more, they will develop a little further. Get my little trug. Oh, wow. Look at those. Oh my goodness. Now, anybody who grows tomatoes, you guys are with me. I know you can appreciate when you see a red tomato on the vine. Now, my Blue Beauty beefsteak tomatoes, they're taking about 5 weeks from the point where I see a tomato forming until they're starting to turn red. So it takes a tremendous amount of patience to get this far with my tomatoes. I get so tempted to just pick them while they're green and fry up some fried green tomatoes. Like, look at that, all these tomatoes. But if you stick it out and you wait until they're red, they're so juicy and delicious. Now, these tomatoes, these beefsteak tomatoes, they don't have a ton of seeds and they don't have a ton of gel like some other tomatoes. They're really thick and juicy and meaty. Now, what I've done, which is so good, is I just slice them up, sprinkle a little bit of salt and pepper on them, a little bit of balsamic, a slice of cheese, and I will just eat them just like that. They also go great on sandwiches. You can cook them in things like spaghetti sauces, but I feel like if you want to do that, you can also grow like a paste tomato. There's so many tomato varieties out there, but these are so good just by themselves. They're incredibly aromatic, very sweet. I mean, man, the Blue Beauty beefsteak tomato is gonna stick around in our garden for years to come. Like, oh, I love it. And it's actually pretty prolific. It started off slow, but now there are so many tomatoes all over each of these plants. I mean, look over here. There's another little fruit there, and there's fruit going all up it. So where I work at a lumber yard here locally, and in my job, I come across a lot of people who like to garden, and a lot of people garden professionally out here. So one thing that I've come across from the locals is almost everybody, when they ask what kind of tomatoes I'm growing, and I say I'm growing beefsteak indeterminate tomatoes, they say, oh, good luck. Everybody out here says, don't grow beefsteak tomatoes. And I'm not sure why. I think they think that it's too hot and dry, and that the amount of time it takes for these to develop, the plants just aren't going to thrive. But I'm really happy that I went ahead and just did it, because these plants are doing really good. And I feel like I'm really glad. I wanted a beefsteak tomato. I went for it, I did it, and they're doing great. Look at how tall they are. They're all having really nice flowers. And I mean, there's more fruit. Everywhere I look, I'm seeing more fruit developing. Now they are kind of big and sprawly. This one actually snapped right here and it was falling down. But what I did was I propped it back up and tied it with some pantyhose because I had run out of my garden twine, and it's still producing fruit. So as long as you support these, they will continue to grow until a frost comes. So we are halfway through our season. I'm sure that as the summer goes on, we probably will start to experience diseases like blight, and we'll have issues with them becoming really tall and not having anywhere to go. But you can successfully grow, I'm pretty sure, anything. Like, obviously some varieties are going to do better in some environments, but look at that. If you think you can do it, try it. Now also listen to the locals. I've learned a lot of things from the advice of the dear people around me that I've come to really love and trust. And now I get locals coming in to the store, and as they're checking out, they're asking me, "So how are your tomatoes doing?" And I'm like, "They're doing good." And everyone's asking me, "So what's on the menu today?" And I'm like, "Yeah, I made some scrambled eggs and chopped up a tomato, chopped up a bell pepper straight from the garden." And I can have those meals where everything comes from something that I've grown. And I just love that lifestyle, and I love that. And it's really cool when you see locals in your community and you build a relationship with them, and y'all share secrets and advice and things that y'all have learned. It's, you know, you can't get anything better than that. There's another really beautiful tomato. Need to wash him off. He's a little dusty. And look at that. See, he cracked a little bit and scabbed over. There's no rot there. And there's another beautiful blue beauty beefsteak tomato. Look at that little spider. Need to put him back in the garden. Come on, spider. There he goes. Blew him off. So I'm going to go around the back side of this garden bed, and I think I see one more tomato that's just out of my reach. Oh, I'm coming around the garden, and look at this little guy. He's already starting to produce his anthocyanins. It's going to be a really beautiful tomato. Oop, sucker. Take that off. Alright, so before I pick this one, here's an example of a green tomato. He's already starting to turn a little bit. It looks like we had like a bird or something that damaged him. Well, if I pick him and set him out on the counter, he'll be red in a day or two. He's already starting to get that red color on him. Look at how beautiful those anthocyanins have come out and displayed. That's going to be a really yummy, delicious, and rich, healthy tomato. You can't buy these in the store. Just take some time and patience, a little love and care, and anybody can grow their own food. Look at that. That's hard work and dedication right there. Oh my gosh, I'm so happy. Look at that tomato. I'm sitting on this rock in the back side of my garden. Before anything started growing, I really used this rock to sit and just look out and try to imagine how my garden would be. I don't think I imagined myself staring at a wall of tomatoes. Oh my goodness. But look, from this side you can really see just how many tomatoes this plant is producing. A little early in the season, if you would have asked me a month and a half ago, I was starting to get a little discouraged that I wasn't gonna get any tomatoes. Like, I saw a couple tomatoes forming on these plants, but mostly I saw a lot of flowers falling off, and I started feeling really discouraged, but I'm glad I just stuck with it and hung in there. I'm new to gardening. I do have a lot to learn. I did a lot of research and thought I would magically just be good at it. And there's so many things that I am learning through trial and error and failure, and just keep getting up and keep going. And look at that. There's tomatoes. all over these, like all over them. Look at that. So give yourself a spot to grow something, and I think you can surprise yourself. There we go. Look at this week's harvest so far. Oh my gosh, I feel like a little girl. I'm so giddy. I just want to squeal. So my watermelon is pretty amazing this week. Look at all these pretty pastel yellow flowers. And it's putting off a lot of new growth, a ton. And I think it's given up on growing this way. The chickens keep eating it down. So look how smart and sneaky this plant has been. It's used this bush to grow up and support itself. And now it is using my fence as a trellis to grow some watermelons. Now, if any of these flowers get pollinated and start to grow a watermelon, I will use the pantyhose trick and tie my watermelon probably to this T-post so that it can be support the weight of a huge watermelon. Because you know, these branches, they will just snap under the weight of a watermelon. Now all of these long-stemmed flowers are male, so they will fall off. But if we get any female flowers growing on here, we might get a watermelon. It's pretty neat. My tomatillos are doing pretty good. This one had a little bit of bug damage, but you can already see the anthocyanins at work. These are purple tomatillos. Most tomatillos are green. These are gonna be purple. And you can see all in here that we are getting plenty more. Oh, look, a little spider. You better eat some bugs, Mr. Spider. You can see plenty more tomatillos that are starting to develop. It's really neat. You know what's cool about gardening? I used to have a phobia of bugs touching me, and now I'm literally brushing against so many bugs, and I'm able to appreciate where they are in their ecosystem instead of just seeing, ooh, a crawly bug, it touched me. I could keep this nice and trim. I probably will trim it, but I was just crawling all through there, and there's praying mantises and spiders and all kinds of little weird beetles that look like little aliens all over this garden. Just gotta get over it. I wanted to show you my little blue butterfly pea. He's starting to put off quite a bit of growth. I can't wait to see his really pretty indigo colored deep blue flowers. I'm gonna grab my trug and my clippers. Let's get out of here. It is hot today. Oh, my pansies are not doing good. They're kind of petering out with how hot it is. Doing, Myrtle? Where's everybody else? Let's check if we have any eggs. Hey, Miss Molly. This is our resident broody. She's actually really friendly for a broody hen. Most broody hens will attack you if you try to reach under them. She is very, very friendly. Now, we don't want her to be broody because we don't have any fertilized eggs for her to sit on. If there are any of you guys who are new to homesteading or don't know very much about chickens yet, a broody hen is a hen that wants to have babies. So it's when her hormones surge and she doesn't want to do anything but sit on eggs. So we actually don't want her to be broody because out here it gets so hot outside that why do we want her to be in this coop for any longer than she needs to be? Most girls come in here, lay an egg, and they leave. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna take her out and move her and hopefully give her an access to water, because chickens who are broody, they will only get up off the nest one time a day to eat, drink, and poop. The rest of the day they sit in this box trying to keep their eggs warm, and then they'll turn the eggs a couple times a day and they'll make sure that they'll be ready to hatch. The thing is, we don't have a rooster. So even though the girls will lay plenty of eggs without a rooster, they won't be fertilized and they won't have chicks inside of them. So her sitting on these eggs is really doing nothing for her. So what we've been doing is every time we see her in here, we take her out, we set her down, and we try to give her access to food and water. She'll usually take a couple bites and then run back in here. Another trick that you can do is you can reduce the temperature of their stomach. So we usually get the water hose and we gently sprinkle a little bit of water on her stomach to cool down her stomach. If you do that a few times a day, it's supposed to break their broodiness. So we've been doing this. This is going to be the third day that we're going to do it today. Every now and then we'll go ahead and grab her and hose her stomach off. And then when she comes back in, it's kind of making her just a little less broody. So let me go ahead and get her out and try to help her snap out of being a broody chicken. At this point, I'll usually go ahead and take any of the eggs that she's been sitting on. Go ahead and add them to my basket. Now look at that. We got even more things today. And Molly, she doesn't hold it against us when we take her out. We're doing her a favor. Look at that. She came out and she ran, and now she's filling up on some cool water. You see, a broody hen, it's all hormone-based. Her stomach starts getting warm, and she'll just sit on eggs all day, and it can last up to a month if you don't do anything about it. Now, we are in the middle of June out here. It's June 22nd, and we are in a desert region. So why is this chicken, for a whole month, gonna sit nonstop in a hot box, you know? So what we're trying to do for her is we are trying to snap her out of being broody by cooling down her stomach a couple times a day. And you can already see every time I bring her out, she comes out, she chugs water, she'll eat a couple bites, and then she's gonna run back and get on the nest here in a few minutes. So probably 3, 4, 5 times a day, I'll just come out here and I'll try to be like, okay, take a break, grab something to drink. And because, you know, if you just were to leave her out to it, she would just sit here and be really, really hot all day. So I'm just trying to look out for my chickens. Now, if we had a rooster and she did have fertilized eggs, this is a great chicken to have on your farm if you want, you know, to have baby chicks. So this isn't a behavior to be ashamed of or to be mad at her for getting. It's completely natural. It's part of having chickens. It's just something you gotta deal with, is that they don't always know what's best for them. So we gotta kinda help her figure out. It's not the time to wanna be a mom. These eggs are not gonna hatch, so. Here are two more of my Blue Beauty beefsteak tomatoes, and again, these do not have any fruit on them, and these are ones that I have not been pruning, but I'm going to go ahead and start pruning because, as an experiment, I didn't prune suckers to try to see if that would help the plant out in this region. A lot of people prune their plants for airflow, not only for production of fruit, and I'm seeing that they go hand in hand. I'm getting a lot of production with foliage that's decreasing the amount of fruit production I get. Y'all saw in the back garden beds, my tomato plants were loaded with tomato fruits, but the only plants that aren't giving me fruit are the ones I'm not pruning. So that is about to change. I'm gonna come out here and just prune all of these suckers. I don't need to wait the whole season to feel like I learned the lesson. So it was an experiment that I thought was really neat, and it was really drastic what pruning does. See, even this right here, this big one that was allowed to get really big, that is a sucker which you can cut off. Now, I try to be careful when you get to the top of your plants. I'm going to go ahead and leave it because once it gets this big, you start to be able to have a harder time distinguishing. Is this the sucker or is it the top of your plant? And if you were to cut off the top of your plant, you're kind of stunting it when you cut the tops of your plants. So you really want to be really careful just to grab the suckers that you're sure about. Look at this. It's my first ripe tomato from my husky red cherry tomato plant. And I have another one that looks like he's ready to come off too. Look at that. Wow, these are gonna be great. They look super juicy. This one I'm probably gonna sit out for another day so he gets really red. But look at that. This tomato plant has more tomatoes coming in. I'm really happy with this. I want to grow more cherry tomato plants next year. This plant was actually given to me from somebody that I work with, and I'm so happy that she gave me one of these because I didn't actually grow any cherry tomatoes from seed this year. This one was a started plant, but I'm glad I'm getting a couple cherry tomatoes. We're gonna add them to the basket. Look at all of this harvest this week. My word. My Art Combs Ancient Watermelon is still doing good. He's little, but he's getting bigger. I can already see it. This lavender plant is actually a gift that I got for my mother-in-law for her birthday, which was last week. It's doing pretty good. That one was store-bought. And then this is a cool little cover plant that has really pretty pink flowers. And I'm planning on planting him, and I just bought this plant, planning on planting him in this umbrella stand that we just built, Reaching Reverie. I don't know, I'm gonna take out the pine cones and fill this with soil. We already drilled some drainage holes in the side all the way around, so I'm gonna plant that. It's gonna be cute, filled with little flowers. I also, this week, planted this pot. This pot had quince bush in it. So this big bush right here is a quince, and it had a fruit that had fallen a few years back, and it had a little propagated quince bush growing from the bottom. And so we took that one out, put it in this pot, lived about 2 years in this pot, and it died over the winter this year. I have two more quince bushes, a couple different varieties, that we're planning on taking with us when we do move, because we fell in love with this quince bush over here and we desperately wanted more. So this one has really pretty pink flowers, the one here has red flowers, and the one in the back has orange flowers. And so we took the dead one out of this pot, which was a baby from that tree, and I planted a lemon cucumber, and I also planted a spaghetti squash. So we'll see how those do. I'm seeing a ton of life in the soil. I saw centipedes and roly-polies. I know roly-polies will eat seedlings, and I'm not sure how good centipedes are for the soil, but we're gonna go ahead and just kind of see how it goes. We're still early enough in the season that I can get a harvest out of these plants. I also sprinkled in, I'm gonna let this plane go by. I also sprinkled in alyssum, and I'm seeing a couple of these pop up, and I also sprinkled in oregano. So I'm not sure if that's oregano or alyssum, but I sprinkled oregano predominantly on this half, and then I did alyssum over the whole pot. Alyssum is a really beautiful little flower that creates almost like a carpet effect with really pretty flowers. This variety, I think it was white, like carpet of snow, I think is what it was called. So they're gonna be little white flowers. And I'm hoping that my squash and my cucumbers will come out, overflow out of the pot, and then this will just be full of flowers for pollinators and maybe a couple of herbs as well. You bringing out the chicken feed? Gonna feed our girls. My bell pepper that's red over here is struggling a little bit with the wind, but its foliage is really nice. I mean, it just kind of flops over a lot. This is another one. I was gifted this plant when I reached 1 year at the place that I work. My coworkers got this plant for me, and it's actually, it is doing really good, and it does have flower blossoms on it, but I haven't seen any fruit yet. It did have a lot of hail damage from our week 8 garden tour. Y'all can go back and see that. But it is putting off a lot of new growth, and it's really green, but I don't know why. It just seems like it just kind of flops around in the wind, so I might need to support it just a little better. My vincas are doing extremely well yet again. They are just thriving in this hot weather, and I probably need to prune this tomato plant a little bit, and I think I'm going to support him a little better too. This is a Blue Beauty tomato plant that I actually cloned basically from a sucker. So when you take a sucker like this off of a tomato plant and you bury it in the ground, all of these little hairy things on the stem will turn into roots, and you can actually make another tomato plant out of something like this. So that's what I did here. You can see he's getting nice and big. And I actually saw a couple flowers on him the other day. I don't know if they fell off or not. Looks like they fell off. There's a couple flowers. But I'm gonna take off those suckers because that is not gonna help him grow fruit. Over here, I have my Market More cucumbers doing really good. My cantaloupe has just decided that it loves life. Look at how big it's getting. It has multiple arms. It's growing in a few different directions. And it has beautiful flowers all up and down this plant, which are making me happy. Very, very happy. Now, my French breakfast radish, which is a monster over here, has finally decided to bolt and go to seed. So these are flowers. They look kind of like broccoli, don't they? It's kind of neat. I'm going to let this flower because I want to save seed from him this year. I've been waiting all season. This was the first plant that was planted in this garden bed at the beginning of the season. I don't know if y'all remember, but I had French breakfast radishes filling up this garden bed. And now he's the lone survivor and he's going to seed. I also think I planted another lemon cucumber. I think that's what that is, and I think that's what that is. I planted a couple more cucumbers. I figured these guys aren't taking up so much space yet that I could probably get another round of cucumbers coming in. So we have the Market More, which is a really pretty long green cucumber and kind of a traditional cucumber. And then the lemon cucumbers are the shape and the color of lemons. And then you cut into them and it's a green fleshy fruit that's a cucumber. So I thought those were really cool. Wanted to try that. My cilantro is developing lots of coriander. So it went to flower and it provided lots of flower for butterflies and things like that. And since those were pollinated, they're going to seed, and that is coriander, which is a beautiful spice, wonderful to have in your kitchen. So in between each of my pole beans, I actually went ahead and sowed more purple potted pole bean seeds. That's really hard to say, purple potted pole bean. And I don't see them coming up yet. I think that might be a bean, but it might be a cucumber. I planted a few lemon cucumbers over here, and I can't remember where I started the beans and where I stopped with the cucumbers. Oh, there's one. Oh my gosh, I see it. So back there, there's a little purple potted bulb bean shoot, and there's another one over here. I am a little nervous because when I started my beans earlier in the season, the roly-polies really got them and hit them hard. But what I'm seeing is that my beans are producing foliage, they're producing flowers, and then the flowers are falling off. And I think that it's so hot and sunny in this spot that it's just not letting them, you know, really develop as fruit. So I'm hoping that adding a second wave of pole beans coming up under these and then leaving these here, these are going to help shade the new beans, and maybe the new ones are going to be able to produce some fruit. So we'll see. My blue cereus sage is looking so good. My catnip is going to flower, and catnip is also really, really beautiful. It has flowers all over this plant. Catnip is a really nice addition to an herb garden. You can pick these leaves and steep them in tea. And catnip has a soothing effect. It's mildly a sedative, but it's really good as an anti-anxiety, just, you know, something to have in your herb cabinet. So at the end of this season, I think I'm gonna pick all of the catnip off of here, dehydrate the leaves, and then grind them up and have them ready, you know, to add to tea. My peppermint balsam is beautiful, but I think it is kind of petering out just a little bit. It is still putting off growth, and it does have fruit that it's developing. I'm kind of bummed that I went conservative planting this behind my beans this year. I was so in love with this plant that I didn't let it to really allow it to grow and shine on its own because I was afraid I was going to kill it with how hot we were. So I really sheltered it, and it can't really be seen in all of its beauty. So next year, I think I'm just going to plant more of these and let them do what they're going to do. Survival of the fittest. Yarrow is doing good. I'm still waiting on my yarrow to flower. This is another good medicinal. And blue butterfly pea in the back is doing pretty good. I'm coming back here to check on my okra because I think there's a couple okra that I can harvest, and I noticed that Molly is out here dust bathing, and that makes me so happy. because it means that she's not acting broody right now. Because earlier, every time in this week where we would take her out, let her get something to eat and drink, she'd grab a couple gulps, grab a couple bites, and run back to the coop to sit on the eggs. And look at her today. She's enjoying the sunshine, sitting in the shade, and she's dust bathing. Dust bathing for chickens is a way that they can keep themselves healthy because they get the dirt up under their feathers, and one, it helps cool them down, but also it helps keep external parasites off of them, like ticks, mites, chicken lice. It helps them stay healthy. So seeing her doing this means that she's taking care of herself, and that makes me so happy. Look at her. She has her eyes closed. She's really having a great time being a chicken. So I'm going to check on her this afternoon. If she's broody, I'm going to pull her out of the box. But this shows me that she's coming out of it. Look, Sunisa's going to join her now. So let's go check on the okra. I saw this while I was harvesting my tomatoes. Look at that monster. Now, okra grows so fast when it goes from flower to fruit that it only takes about 3 or 4 days before they're ready to harvest. If you go just one day too long, it takes off and it gets huge. And the bigger the okra is, the more tough and less edible it kind of seems. So I really need to pick this okra. Girls are watching what I'm doing. Don't you get any ideas, Yasha? All right, everybody, we're gonna take one last look at the harvest that we were able to do for the week 12 garden tour this week. Let's start with the eggs. We got 4 really beautiful, large cream and brown eggs. Now, this is still early in the day, so we're probably gonna double this by the afternoon. I got a couple cherry tomatoes, a handful of ground cherries, a handful of black Hungarian jalapenos. We got some okra. This one's a little big, but he's gonna be really good. And then we got 4 really beautiful blue beefsteak tomatoes. Blue beauty beefsteak tomatoes. There it is. Makes me so proud and happy. Phew, guys, it's getting hot out there. I think it's time for me to go in and have some sweet cucumber lemonade. So let's wrap this up. All right, guys, it is so hot today. If you want to see how to keep your chickens cool in the hot weather, go ahead and click the bottom right and that'll take you to that video. Maybe this is the first time you're watching one of our garden tours and you want to catch up on all the action. I have an entire playlist dedicated to our weekly garden tours. Click the top right and it'll take you there. Well, I loved having a good time with you guys. Thank you for coming to the harvest. Thank you for joining me on the week 12 garden tour, but I'm gonna get inside. It's a little warm. So you guys have a great afternoon and I'll see y'all next week. Thank you so much for watching. Don't forget to subscribe. Good night. Mary, I think they like their new scratch. Like, this is some good stuff.
There's another poop in there.
She's not gonna poop in there.
Come on, Mary.
Says, I wanted a good taste of this new stuff. Man, that looks amazing. We switched what scratch we use, and look at that. That looks nice. The girls like it. Are you filling up the bird feeder?
Yeah.
So we're going to put this for the wild birds. All right. Look at that. That way, as the wild birds are eating and they toss it to the ground, the chickens aren't eating just junk food. They're also getting some nice conditioner scratch. And this is just a treat for them. This is not their primary diet. They still get layer pellets as their primary diet. We also give them a lot of scraps from the kitchen. Anything that we're going to throw out that is edible comes out here to the chicken.